Reason and lessons, it's not so much scale up copy exactly, it's grow up with adaptions and skill. Either you have to have a skilled gardener like Mary, and she used to test the environment with her little pH thing, and she would nurture it till it's mature in the kitchen under special conditions until it could survive outside. Or you buy a seed variety that's designed for that particular environment, that it does well in that soil or in that microclimate. And you make the analogies. Your environment is financing, regulation, culture. And you have an implementation infrastructure. Your internal ones in your groups, your project teams, the external one is the university best practices and other aspects of that internal. So, now, turning on to the solutions, I need to go very quickly. I'm going to mention three solutions. The first solution, to get to zero preventable heart attacks, I'm not sure about strokes, we debate that, and then there's the diabetic complications, and then there's how all of this, that comes together, which is really crucial issue, but I'm going simply for the moment on, okay, zero preventable heart attacks, and the way to do it, I would say, is, well, you change your definition of preventable to make this a reasonable target. We've talked about what we could do is we could grow the scale up of the clinical individual approach by developing our leadership, developing our project management within the physician organization. We can do the individual clinical approach. The second one is extend the scope of this group and your approaches to patient adherence. And there's some superb behavioral science and social aspects on that. And I'll say very quickly a few words about that. The third solution is to reach more in need, but with the capacity to engage. So there are a lot of people who potentially could benefit from your clinical approaches, but you don't reach or activate so well, and they also may need a bit of help to get on board and with sustaining their meds in other ways. So you could extend it in that way within your own population. Now I think the biggest win is for it's cut it off here. This is reaching the most in need that you know nothing about. And I think data soon will be showing you who these people are, undocumented, uninsured, but ultimately they may show up in your emergency room, like the example earlier, and they may get admitted. And all you need is 20, 30, 40 of those a year, and this does affect the bottom line if we're looking at it from a financial perspective. So, very quickly, extend the scope to patient adherence. The quick way, this is the quickest potted summary of behavioral theory in the social science approach, Ethan Heach, Switch, How to Change Things When They're Hard. And they've done a great popular airport book that summarizes a lot of research, very useful approaches.
I'm just going to help you by giving you a clock here. So you have another 12 minutes, and then we'll go to questions.
All right. Okay, very quickly. Insurance-sponsored weight management, not great news. Essentially, not many people maintain the weight management approach. This is what's called the voltage drop or the dilution in terms of take-up and sustaining different approaches. This is another one. This was a summary of a review of a number of studies. This is how many physicians are aware of the guidelines, how many agree in principle that they're going to do it, how many actually do it consistently, and then how many sustain it. What we've got here, this is the statin statins, and chronic heart failure, and LDL is that one. Okay, for aspirin, 12% agree, so that's fairly okay. 20% agree and adopt beta blockers, and that stays constant. 40% cholesterol. So they, from going from agreeing to actually adopting, there's a big drop there in the arm. And then adhering to chronic heart failure, you get a big voltage drop. And this is a summary from empirical studies and what people actually do. And this is a bit sobering. Why are the gaps? Well, here's a guess, and this is based on Glasgow. 50% of services decide to adopt it. So what percentage of patients may benefit? Well, 50%. 50% of clinicians prescribe. We are down to 25. 50% of patients collect the prescriptions and start. We're down again. 50% adhere correctly over the first week. 50% actually benefit. After 6 months, how many adhere and benefit? After 2 years. Okay, you get the point.
But now, these are averages. Are those averages across multiple countries?
No, this is total guess. It's based on educated speculation. All right? Now, I invite you, and this is on the plus side, I invite you to think about what's, given that thinking, what do you think is actually the case? All right, well, let's go into some of, this is 2009 American Heart Association. Not filled, not started, not finished. Okay? And that is based on empirical data. Which takes us to, all very well, but is there an effective intervention? Can we do something about it? Well, yes, Kaiser has done a brilliant one. And I do hope, what's the name of that force of nature, the pharmacist? Do you remember her name? From Kaiser, who, you'll tell us later.
I think it's Arakalian.
That's
Dr.
it.
Dr. Arakalian Los Angeles area pharmacist talking about tools for increasing adherence.
Yes, and so Kaiser doesn't need the evidence, strong evidence, to know this is the way to go. And they've got it much better since then. This is fairly old information. Their strategy for enabling their patients to adhere. And you know, they have the financial incentives to do this. And this goes with, this is an add-on to the Kaiser clinical intervention in your field. Okay, solution three, reach more in need, but with the capacity to engage. And this is a Kaiser one. And you might criticize it, but they evaluated patients' readiness to change. And they were pretty brutal about this. Sorry, we'll only work with those who we think have a reasonable chance of taking it up. And again, you can argue the ethics of that, but the ethics also apply to, well, don't waste your resources if you're not going to make a difference. Now, reach most in need and address the disparities. Are there effective social interventions? Well, we've got strong evidence for different social influences impacting heart disease, but the evidence for only a very small proportion of interventions to modify those. And there are tremendous costs and complications of a multi-sector, multi-level approach to keep together the coalition and keep it coordinated to work at a very broad population level across different health systems and memberships. So that's the challenge there. I would argue that the strength of evidence needs to be proportional to the risks of harm, the costs and needs of implementation here. So, I don't know if you use readback. Could you read back to me what address you're going to pick me up at what time? It doesn't take long, but it can save a lot of money. So no risks of harm, very little cost to implement. Do we need a randomized control trial about whether that method is effective? Well, there's never been one done, but it is often used. But as regards the CT scan and calcification, we might need a bit stronger evidence, because there may be risk of harm, there may be costs and ease of implementations which are higher. So all I'm saying is, let's get use the proportionality principle here. Other examples of effective interventions. There are examples for Hispanic, Afro-Americans, rural practices of using a social intervention approach as well as the clinical. So I'll just say there are models and things that you can use. So I'll finish off on that. The key point, the data is going to reveal more populations not reached. And these are populations who potentially are in the figures of deaths from heart attack and stroke and hospitalizations. You potentially can have a larger impact on those most in need and not in contact, but you're less certain about the evidence for the interventions, and the evidence for the interventions are more challenging. And there is cost and complexity to that. So do you stick with what you know is effective and leave this out, or do you take the risks? And I'll leave that question. Let me remind you, 70 years or so ago, who knows the name of these beaches? Uta, Omaha, Gold, Juno, Sword. That is where many Americans died as they just hit the beaches under gunfire from the Germans. The film Dunkirk is actually very, very good, and it just reminds us what our fathers and relatives went through when they hit those beaches, what their chances were. And that was just the beginning as they pushed the Germans back to Berlin. How certain were they of success? They put off the bombing, the ships, for a day or two because of bad weather. The window was closing. They had to make a decision in uncertainty. Remember Dunkirk 4 years earlier had failed miserably. Well, some say it was a big success, but they had this in their minds. Yes, there were the Americans there that made the biggest difference. But this was a big risk, a big, big risk. And this was a coordinated approach to say, we've got to do this. We've got to try. And what they did, in a week, they held the beachhead, and it was touch and go for a week, not just the weather beforehand, and many people died, and they pushed through. And that became the thrust and work on Berlin. So what I've been saying is there are challenges. There are proven interventions, and you have a proven implementation infrastructure. The implementation infrastructure and your implementation can do much better. Maybe concentrate on continuing to implement better amongst all of our physicians more consistently the clinical intervention. But I'm just raising the aspect of look at the potential extra impact you have if you just add support for patient adherence and the social aspect of that. And then you could build on that to those that you know about that aren't engaged and in contact, and take a social approach to that. And you may even, in time, as a group, be able to deal with the population health. And these are choices and risks to take. But I think, looking down over the next 10 years, something has to happen, and something has to bring you together. And I think the data revolution is going to be a very important part of that. So I'm going to leave you with some questions. I'm not going to go through that, but other questions is raising questions about a multi-strategy approach. that can be based on research. Which of these seven that I'm going to list are you doing or could you do? Who is most at risk and where? How are they motivated and providers activated to address the challenge? Are we good on access, especially internet and other services? Are we enabling providers to make more use of these effective interventions? Could we do more to make it easier for our physicians to do the right things? Are we enabling patients, lifestyle and medications? And this is the missing bit at the moment. How much are we doing on empowering communities, faith-based groups and others where some of the high-risk folks are? And are we coordinating and collaborating, especially where we have hospital cardiologists, primary care practitioners, nurse case managers? How are we doing the information systems? So I'll finish there. Sorry if I've gone over time, Hattie.
You hit the timing perfectly. We have 5 minutes for questions now. Thank you for keeping an eye on that clock, and what a great presentation. Do we have questions from our attendees here, or? Dr. Bomber.
So, I would love to have your printout, your spreadsheet of how many of my patients make these criteria for successful management, et cetera. Is that provided to you by the healthcare system, the single payer system, or is it provided by your hospital individually to you?
Not every physician has access to that dashboard. It's a combination. The national government has built the infrastructure. Then it's up to each hospital or each the group that owns the board central to use the data or work with people who've done it elsewhere and put that in place. In Sweden, we're very good in building the infrastructure, but it's the last bit where we slip down. Whereas in the States, if you put investment into EMRs and the data systems, you tend to make sure that you finish the last bit to get the actionable information and make it work for you and patients. So it's variable, and I don't want to give the impression that every primary care physician can immediately press the button and get that list. But I'm just showing you an example of what's possible in a number of areas, and that's what we're trying to move towards.
Other discussion points? Could you say your name, please?
I'm Eduardo Velasco from Toro University. The samples that you provided, most of them, or some of them, are from the US. In Sweden, do you have a public approach to this building of capacity and infrastructure, or is it decentralized with the...
Well, in Sweden, we have 21 different Kaisers, essentially. 21 different county health systems that are geographically based. There are differences in how they do it, but they're at a national level. You have data collection of a number of national databases, which each individual county builds its infrastructure. I think the main thing here is every county has its operations bureaucracy with to manage operations, budgets, planning, your standard bureaucracy. More and more counties are developing a what I call a transformation infrastructure, which is about changing care pathways, putting in data systems that will disrupt everyday operations for a period until these new better ways are in place and working. And they found it necessary to have both a operational bureaucracy but a transition infrastructure to keep the tension between operations and a consistent approach to bringing in the five-year way of working. Otherwise, it will never get implemented because operations dominate and budgets and finance dominate, and we're always short-staffed, and we never create the gap to bring in that change where we will drop for a bit before we get the advantages of that new way of working. So what I'm saying is there are big differences across Sweden in those health systems, but many do have versions of this operations and transition structures. And there are also national transition structures that work with counties to help them make different transitions, especially the data ones.
Thank you so much, Dr. Overtveit. That was a beautiful presentation. And as we transition to our next speaker, Dr. Chloe Bird, who will be introduced by Dr. Bommer, I just want to say that one very important thing that we did in our first University Best Practices in San Diego was we instituted the Kaiser Bundle with the help of one of the originators of the Kaiser ALL Bundle, which is aspirin, lisinopril, and lipid-lowering agent statin, which they're now... So having the creator of that bundle in the room with us every single month advocating for that, advocating and having also an advocate who was the longtime editor of the Journal of the American College of Cardiology, hammering consistently on not only LDL 100, but truly LDL 70. And now you heard him here recently talking about LDL 50, and he keeps his LDL to 34. So if you lower the LDL of a population through a variety of lifestyle and medication management, what do you think is going to happen? The data is very clear, and Bill Bommer can tell us more about that. Anyway, Bill, thank you for introducing Dr. Bird.
So thank you very much. It is still raining outside, so you might as well stay here. We're delighted that our next speaker, Chloe Bird, is the senior social scientist at the RAND Corporation. As such, she focuses her research on women's health and social determinants. She's served as a PI or co-PI on multiple NIH-funded grants, 15 years of experience conducting assessments of gaps in the quality of care for cardiovascular disease. She has worked for a number of services, AHRQ, CMS, and VA, all important letters that refer to major healthcare agencies in the U.S. She analyzes patterns of quality of care. She has a book, Gender and Health, and she focuses this work on the study of health and healthcare disparities, shedding light on how decision makers, employers, and policymakers can help improve healthy life for all of us here. I'm happy to introduce Chloe for our next speaker.
Good afternoon. So I'm going to be speaking to you today. I wrote this while, over the past fiscal year, I was a senior advisor at the NIH Office for Research on Women's Health. And so as long as I'm on script, I'm not currently a Fed, but I'm talking about work that was approved there. Anything else I say is my opinion and not theirs, not NIH, not Office for Research on Women's Health, and RAND has the same caveats. So most of the time you're just talking to me, but I spend a lot of time talking to people about this work. So today I'm going to be talking about how we can increase knowledge about the health of women by advancing our understanding of sex and gender influences on health and disease. So let's talk about sex and gender and health. And the mission of NIH is to seek fundamental knowledge about the nature and behavior of living systems and the application of that knowledge to enhance health, lengthen life, and reduce illness and disability. My question is, how are we doing with regard to the health and longevity of women? Well, we have a few pieces of data that highlight the challenge. First, while in the United States, men have continued to make gains in longevity, this red dot is the US, this is the distribution across high-income countries in terms of the probability of making it to age 50. And so for men, the other countries have been getting better, but it's been hanging in there. Women haven't been doing so well. For US women, we've fallen far behind our other high-income peer countries. We've literally dropped off the tail of the distribution by a long stretch here. And if you put these on the same scale, men have made much bigger gains here than the women have. So we're interested in why women's life expectancy has plateaued. In many counties in the US, life expectancy plateaued for women, even as it continued to have significant increases for men. So these are the only counties where it stayed level for men, these ones in yellow. Over here, we see all of the areas where women didn't make a gain, or in red, where they actually had declines in life expectancy. So we see these differences in survival trends. And there's a larger debate taking place as to why women's life expectancy isn't improving in the United States. The large variation in life expectancy also occurs across counties, and is accompanied by these state-to-state variation in policies. And this is a very interesting piece of work that Jennifer Montes and colleagues did. They looked at state-level mortality and looked at how much variation we have. Red is where you have the highest mortality rates for women, yellow the lowest. So we start out with the age-adjusted mortality rates across all of the states for women. And then they added in individual characteristics. So we already had age, they added race, ethnicity, education, employment status, family income, marital status. That explained about 30% of the variation. And then they put in state characteristics, economic environment, social cohesion, socio-political orientation, physical infrastructure, and the tobacco environment, tobacco policy. And this explained another 32% of the variation. So it's clear that much of what's going on is not things that are actually under an individual woman's control. They're not under women's, they're not just a function of women's characteristics, but the health environments in which we live, including the tobacco environment. Well, not surprisingly, we need to take that into account. We need to look at how do we raise the bar on women's health and not just focus on how we're going to change behavior of individuals, but how we're going to make a broader change. So today I'm going to talk about the ways in which we can advance research to raise the bar. So what's the responsibility on our side? And I'm thinking in part that what you do here in University of Best Practices, and I've been involved in the groups for some time, is look at how we can use the data to better understand and better intervene. I'm interested in how do we improve our conceptual model of sex and gender influences on health and disease? How do we change how do we see what's missing in the way we think about it? Pay a lot more attention to what we do know and what we don't know, because that's one of the places that we often go wrong. We assume we know something we actually haven't ever studied. And at the end, to be able to ask better questions of the data, of our practices, of ourselves. So let's start with the conceptual model. Now, when we study animals, it's simpler. The differences between males and females are biological. When we study humans, there's sex differences, and there are also gender differences, which are associated with the social and environmental contexts in which we live. So for humans, both sex and gender influence health. Now, in some cases, we know that their differences in health and disease are biological in origin. These include cancer in sex-specific organs, or sex-linked diseases, such as hemophilia, which is much more common in males than females. There are one or two variants that are pretty uncommon that occur in females. But at the other end of the spectrum, there are not as many things that we can come up with. There are probably some categories where we can say there are health differences that are purely social in origin, but not so many. One that comes to that has come to mind or been argued in the past is are the differences in violence, in violent behavior, or in violence between men and women purely social? in origin.